to this week's show. It's an absolutely beautiful sunny afternoon, a little bit nippy around the extremities, but nevertheless, I've been sent down to the George at Thruxton, and I'm with Pauline New. Very appropriate name, because Pauline is new. She's only been here a week. You're the new chef, aren't you?
That's right.
And what are you going to conjure up for us today, Pauline?
Traditional steak and ale pie.
Lovely. Good country fare. Nothing like it. Let's get inside. It's freezing. I'm in the kitchen, Pauline's at my side, and she's just about to chop an onion. It's the kind of thing you do when you're making a steak pie. Over to the left. So Pauline, tell me how this all starts, this steak pie, apart from the onion.
We chop the onion up, and then what I do with this steak is I actually marinate it for about 2 hours in some Guinness.
Ooh.
So it's nice and cooked. And then I add like the onion, mushrooms, and then some bay leaves, just to give it an extra bit, some extra flavour. And then a little salt and pepper, not a lot.
Not a lot. Why not a lot?
Because I'm one of these chefs that I think about people that can't have salt.
Oh yes,
at least
course.
If the salt,
they can add it.
They can add, but you can't take away.
Sure. Very sensible, Pauline. As a cook, worried about your health. Okie Dex. So we're going to take this onion a little bit closer to you, Mike. Over to the frying pan. And into the fire.
Yeah, definitely.
Oops. Oh, you didn't put any oil or butter in there, Pauline.
There's some already in there. Right, that is the onion just
okay. Sizzling nicely.
Sauteed off.
Now, this large sort of bowl full of a concoction is actually pre-cooked meat, but you're going to add that, aren't you?
I'm going to add it in because of the fact it has to, the meat has to be cooked. You can't. It'd be too tough if you just threw it in there now. It would be cooked.
So pre-cooked in the Guinness?
Yes.
And then add it to the onions?
That's right.
Now, what about the mushrooms? Are they in there as well?
Yes, mushrooms in there as well.
Everything's in there.
Yeah.
But there's one thing you miss out on here. You can't smell this lovely food. I can.
Actually, I'm just cooking it through, just heating it up, ready to be served out for the customer after I've rolled the pastry lid.
Is this ready to go in the oven now?
Yes, well, it is. I just put it into a bowl now,
okay.
And then I'll roll out the pastry lid.
I'm such a good chef's help. Is that the one you want?
Thank you.
Mind your fingers.
Don't burn my fingers, Pauline.
Yeah. I know your type. Plenty of gravy.
That's right.
Not that you call
plenty
it gravy.
Plenty of meat.
Yes, plenty of meat. Great. Looking good.
Okay. That is ready just to go into the oven and then the pastry lid on
minus
top.
Its pastry lid. It's all lonely and we're going to go and get the pastry ready now. Follow us. Chief roller outer. You know, Mike's getting into some very strange positions today. Hello.
I wouldn't like his job.
That's very smart looking. Are these all sort of little, dare we say it, pre-packed?
Packed.
Yeah. They do some pretty marvellous pastries pre-packed nowadays, don't they? It's very clever, Pauline.
Right, now
can't
that
roll
is,
pastry.
I can't make pastry, I've got two hot hands.
Ah, that's very true actually, yes, because you can't have warm hands on your making.
Right, this is ready now to go onto the
okay.
top of the pie.
Chef's assistant. Very smart, Pauline. May I pinch with you?
Yeah.
Is it sort of a thummy job? You do all this, don't you?
Yeah.
Little pinchy marks.
Normally you go in like that.
Oh, do you? Okay.
Makes a nice little pattern around it.
I'm learning. This sort of thing you do with your mother as a child, and if you're
certainly
like me, you then never do it again. Great, and off it comes.
And then it's brushed with egg white.
You know what you make with those, don't you? You make little jam rollovers.
And then just a quick brush with egg.
To make it go nice and golden.
Golden brown.
There's a song about that, isn't there? Golden brown, da 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 da. Yep. Great.
Yeah.
The oven's ready.
Goes in there for about 10 minutes.
Pauline, time for a drink at the bar. And I am where any sensible citizen should be. At the bar, of course. And I'm standing the other side of the bar to Nick. Hello, and Rachel, hi. Members of staff, very important people. Nick, you're the relief manager here.
Yes, I am, yes.
And how long have you been here?
The actual building's been here about 80 to 100 years, myself about 8 months.
Not quite as long?
Not quite as long, not yet.
What do you think of country life then, Nick?
It's very different, you know, very slow, a bit different, plenty of slow life around here, but it's good.
Getting used to it?
Yeah, the ups and downs like any other life.
A bit different to the smoky city, isn't it?
Yeah, it is, very much
so. So I'm looking forward to this meal. What is the food the mainstay of this park?
No, it's not. We have a lot of regular trade around here. We obviously rely on the quieter evenings, our drinkers and our regulars. But obviously the main trade, you know, comes in the summer on the food. We just try and do both together.
Lovely.
Sounds like a good combination. Well, I think my steak's nearly ready, so my steak pie. I think it's time to whet the appetite with a nice glass of dry white wine, don't you?
Let's go.
Mike, thank you, darling. You're too kind. Cheers. Well, here I am with my napkins, pink for a girl, blue for a boy, and I'm waiting for Nick to join me. I can see something happening. This is exciting.
Champagne as well,
man. Oh, Nick, you're spoiling me.
There we go.
Sweetie, you're going to sit down and join me for a glass?
Yes, certainly.
Are you good at popping these things?
No,
I've never done it in my life. Really, what do you do? Okay, you hold the mic and tell me what to do. I seriously have never done this.
Go on. If you slowly pull the top out, unscrew it.
Right.
And that's
it. To aim it over there, is that safe?
Yeah. Now what you got to do is help the top out itself. Has to push it out. Now you got to release it with your hand.
And what do? I hold it back a bit or just go poof?
Just go poof.
Really? Oh God.
Yeah, get the atmosphere in. Give it a bit of a shake as well. There you go.
Simple, really. Would you like a glass?
Oh yes, please. Oh. Thank you.
Gave myself a fright then. Would I make a good member of staff? Is this neat enough? not too bad. A bit of a dribble down that one. You've never.
Don't worry about it. Thank you very much indeed. Cheers.
Well, I think we're just about ready for our lunch now, don't you, Nick?
Yes, I think she's coming round for it now.
Oh, is she? Oh, Pauline! Ah ha ha ha! The magic lady. Thank you very much. Gosh, that looks absolutely lovely. Thank you.
Thank you.
Bon appetit to me. I think Nick's waiting for my opinion. Not that it really matters. I think he ate earlier. Absolutely delicious.
Certainly got the January blues. It's just after Christmas. I have no money left, and actually I do have a few parties still left to go to. So I have £20 and I'm here at the Oxfam shop in the Chelmsford Centre to see if I can kit myself up with £20. This is Phamie's challenge number 3. Let's go inside and see what they've got. Well, I'm inside now. I'm with Maureen Hosier, who is the volunteer manager of the shop here.
Hi there.
Hello. And as I say, I've got the January blues. Are you going to help me find something nice to wear to cheer me up?
Yeah, I'm sure we've got some nice cheerful things. And I think we can start here with these jackets on the right.
Let's have a look over here. I mean, with your clothes here at Oxfam, how often do you get new clothes bought in by people?
Well, we're getting things through the door every day, but we can also phone up a depot and every couple of weeks we get new stock coming in. So
if people are looking around for something, it's worth coming in, say, every day or every other day, and you can always find what you're looking for.
It's the stock's always changing and you come in quickly and then you get the really nice stuff.
Now, I'm going to try some of these on. Could you hold my microphone for me?
Certainly.
I've got £20 here. I'll put it in your pocket,
right.
You can pass it for me. And I'm going to try some things on. I'm going to see what I can find for £20. Can I leave this over here, ladies? Thank you.
Okay.
No, this is lovely. This is bright and colourful. This is kind of a ski jacket, isn't it?
Yeah. And very bright and colourful. I think it's about the right size.
Think it's me?
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah, absolutely right on you.
Right.
Actually, yeah, it's really nice.
It's lovely. Now, how about a scarf to go with this?
Yes.
Do you have a scarf
The shawls are here, and the smaller scarves, and the sort of finer fabrics at the end.
So what would you recommend to go with this nice bright yellow?
Well, I think you want something quite warm. Actually, this one. Well, we've got everything here.
That's great. I'm going to try this one on.
Okay.
Put that up there. What kind of people do you get looking... I'll hold the microphone for a sec while I just ask you another question. What kind of people do you get coming in and looking around and looking for clothes?
Absolutely everybody. People who just want a change of wardrobe. People looking for a colour that isn't actually in the other shops. And it's a bit of an Aladdin's cave here, you know. People never know what they're going to come across. Mm-hmm. And they have fun, going through the old and the new stuff.
Because you do have some old stuff, and you do have like brand new things that are bought in. People have maybe worn them once, decided they didn't like it.
Yes, and we have, things sort of 30, evening things 30 years old. So
really?
We have quite an incredible range.
Great. Now, how about the scarf then, Mike? What do you think? Scarf? He says yeah. Yeah, not too sure. I don't know, what do you think? Nobody's saying yes, they're all just looking at me going,
cool. Have a go at this. It's a bit more severe, but
I'll pop that over there. Let's have a go at this. I must say, I do like scarves, actually. I'm going to take this one off. If I can just chuck it to these lovely ladies who have stood over there. Thank you, looking after all my things over there, doing a great job. And they're all volunteers as well.
They're all voluntary, and they come for a minimum of 4 hours a week. Some come for 2 days a week. And we have over 30 volunteers here. People work in the back if they like sorting and pricing up goods.
Must be great fun if you're a clothes fan to work here and see all the amazing things that come through the doors and have a good rummage around before they get onto the shop floor. Oh, it's all colour-coded. I didn't realise. It's all colour-coded. This is the purple section, the pink and purple section.
That's right.
Nice bit of purple.
Bright reds.
Oh, yeah, let's go and have a look at the bright reds. I like bright colours. And it is January and it is a bit kind of dark and dreary. Oh, look at this. Now, isn't that fantastic? I don't know if you can see this properly, but it's all silky and it's beautiful. Isn't that great? I think that would be a little bit too small for me, which is a shame.
Yeah.
How much would you get something like this for? What did that say there? £10?
£9.95.
That would take up half my budget. That's great. How often would you get something nice like this then?
Well, it's not run-of-the-mill, but there'd be sort of, well, I suppose 10% of this sort of, you know, something... a little bit different and not your, you know.
So if you hunt around, if you come into Oxfam and you have a good hunt round, you can pick up things like this. Mm-hmm. Beautiful, unusual looking things.
Yeah, that's the sort of model.
Hidden away.
Yeah. We'll get around to that later, but we've also got a special collection bit where we put the, the quality, the designer things. Ooh. If we get them.
That sounds like we want to go and have a look at that in a minute. What? Oh, this is nice as well. A nice velvet jacket. £6. I mean, you wouldn't get that in the shop for £6, would you?
No, that's really, really good value. And I think velvet jackets are quite fashionable with this sort of lapel now.
Now, again, I think that's a little bit too small for my ample frame, which is a shame.
That's a nice one. What have we got here? We've got red jeans.
Lovely. I tell you what, I love coloured denim. You know,
great
coloured things around here.
Some Levi's here, actually.
Oh, my God. Right, that's it. I'm having these. Levi's are very expensive. And I'm all caught up now.
That's a 14. That's a 14.
Oh, too big.
Too big. Never mind.
All right, let's move on to the designer section that you were telling us about.
Yes.
Because I'd like to... where are we? You point me here. Is this it?
Yeah, it's generally some of the more interesting labels that we have in stock, you know, and obviously what you have here varies and from week to week, day to day, and you can get a whole brilliant load of things in, and it just whatever's sort of a bit more interesting comes in. That's actually really nice. That's sort of Irish wool and hand crochet. That's
lovely.
A red planet skirt. Nice colour, but I don't think the style's you.
No, it's not me, is it? Not really me. Well, that's something quite funky and colourful. How about finding something a little bit more sophisticated? Oi! Out! All right, so I do look a bit daft, but I think I need a hat. Goes with my outfit? Is it me? Well, I've been kitted out by Maureen. Maureen, what do you think?
I think it's absolutely brilliant. I think the trousers are wonderful. Yeah, lovely.
How much are these trousers?
Trousers are $4.99.
They're velvet. You can't see this on television, but they're velvet. They're lovely. And the jacket?
The jacket is $4.99.
Did you catch that?
That's fine.
Oh, that's okay. $4.99 for the jacket.
Yes.
This beautiful woolen thick jacket, all fully lined, lovely green lining.
Yeah.
And how about the very illustrious
$3.99.
So it came to a grand total of?
Check my bit of paper here. $13.97.
$13.97.
That's absolutely wonderful. Yes.
That's great. Yeah. So $13.97, and I still have enough change to go out on the town in my new outfit. So tell me, Maureen, in buying these clothes, what have I actually contributed to?
Well, the money we raise in this shop goes to help our partners overseas, generally small communities who are trying to help themselves, and Oxfam will give practical advice on a low budget, things like small business projects, farming, water supply, health.
And that's all in the third world countries, I presume?
Yeah. Yes, that sort of work, yes.
Yeah.
Yes.
Is there anything done closer to home?
Oxfam has a relatively new area of work in this country, which is separate from our work in the third world, but we are working in Britain now, and that is a separate sort of programme. And we also provide a market for fairly traded craft goods from this country and third world.
That's one thing we didn't look at. We'll get Mike to have a quick little scoot around these new things here, because you do have new trade craft goods here that people can come and buy apart from the second-hand clothes.
Yes. Okay. We have as I was saying, we have the goods that are part of our fair trade programme, which range from foodstuffs to dyes, cushion covers. And we also have a range of things from workshops in this country.
Brilliant.
That's our good neighbours project.
Brilliant. A worthwhile shop. Even if you just want to come in and buy yourself a new jacket, you're doing some good for not only the third world, but your own country too.
Yeah, definitely.
That's brilliant. Thank you ever so much, Maureen. Thanks. There you go.
Thank you.
Lovely. Thank you. Well, I've got my change. I'm all swanked up. Oh, and out. I'm off out on the town. I'll see you soon.
Very nice.
With me this morning is Derek Tempero, who's written a wonderful book, A Pictorial History of Andover, and it's very, very interesting, so get it. Morning, Derek.
Good morning, Tony.
Thanks for coming today to talk to us about this book.
Oh, I'm delighted to come and talk about it. I'm well steeped in Andover's history, I hope. I've studied it now since I've been retired for 10 years and many more years before that.
You were born in Andover?
No, I was born just outside of Andover at Enham Village Centre. It was the first disabled ex-serviceman village, one of the first to be built after the First World War, and I happened to be the first boy born in the village.
And you've been here?
Today, of course, it is Enham Manor Main.
You've been here all your life since then?
I've been here all my life, yes.
Now, you were editor of the Andover Advertiser.
I started as a cub reporter way back in July 39, good. At 52.5p a week, I might add.
Luxury.
I was paying £1 a week for my digs, so my parents had to subsidise me.
Now, what gave you the idea for this book?
Well, the idea came not so much from me, it came from the publishers. I was approached by the publishers and asked if I would do a pictorial history on Andover as part of their series. And I agreed to do it for them. Initially, when I had my interview with the then publications editor, he wanted it done for 2 years' time, and I wasn't particularly keen on that. So we left it that I'd make up my mind whether I'd do it or not for them in 2 years. But I was only home a couple of hours, but I had a telephone call to say that one of their authors had dropped out, and they wanted to put in the 1991 schedule, and could I do it for them in a short space of time? And I did it for them in 6 weeks.
It's on sale here. It's on sale in Andover, isn't it?
It's on sale in Andover, yes.
In Holmes?
No. At Hammocks and at Smith's, as far as I know.
Yeah. Where did you get all the material for this, all these photographs?
Well, quite a few of the photographs I had myself, which I've collected over the years. As I say, I've always been interested in Andover history, but I had a lot of friends who I knew collected old photographs of Andover, and I went round and begged and borrowed them from them, acknowledged them in the book. But who I was more grateful to anybody was to John Marchmont, who is one of the best collections of pictures of old Andover anyone ever had anywhere, I should think. He's got hundreds and hundreds of them, and he helped me out considerably by doing a lot of copies for me of old pictures.
Derek, have you seen many changes over the years?
Oh, considerable. Before we had town development, when the agreement was signed in 1961 to take town development, before that, Andover was a dying town. One's got to be honest about it. We had an ageing population. Our old age people were about 1.6 above the national average, and there were hardly any jobs at all for the younger people of the town. They had to go out to get jobs, and it was with the arrival of town development that really saved Andover. Otherwise Andover would have been a backwater.
You mean the overspill?
Yeah, the overspill, the town development, yeah, taking factories and population from London. That was the salvation of the town. As to its faults, some have been good, some have been poor. I think basically it was a shame to see so many of the older buildings destroyed, but that had to be done to make way for the new town centre. But when you think of Andover today, if you read your national newspapers or even your own local newspaper, we've hardly any unemployment in the town at all. There's 4 or 5 pages of situations vacant every week in the local paper.
Which is a very big plus.
The employment situation in Andover is really on the up. Yeah. And I remember reading before Christmas, the 12th fastest growing town in the country. I imagine now we're even greater.
Right, I'm going to have a look around. And if I could borrow that book, I will buy one.
You can certainly borrow it and have a good look around for yourself and see what the old parts of Andover are left.
Thanks a lot, Derek.
Pleasure.
I'm off now.
Pleasure.
See you later.
Bye-bye.
Hello. I'm armed with a great book. It's a book, it's Andover Pictorial History. Now, a lot of people say that Andover's been ruined by all the changes. I personally don't think so. I still think we've got the character in Andover that we need here. But you can judge for yourself, because we're going to have a look at Andover old and new. So, watch this space. Obviously, a lot of places have changed around, but maybe not as much as you think. You just have a look closely at some of the things around. And this is the top of the high street. This picture was taken 91 years ago. I don't see much difference in that. Obviously there have been some changes. I'm up in Chantry Street at the top of the town at the moment. On my left here It's completely changed, but we've still got some lovely buildings down here on my right. We're at the other end of town now, in Bridge Street, and if you're from Andover, you'll probably recognise it because we've got the post office, which was built in 1913. This photograph was taken in 1917. Now, if you look behind me, you'll probably recognise the White Hart Hotel. We're going to be bringing you a series called Changing Times, which will cover Andover, Salisbury, Romsey and Amesbury. So please watch out for it. Once again, we're in Leslie Thomas's house, and it's great, great to be back with him because I know it was so popular the last time Leslie was on the show, which is almost 18 months ago. Leslie, it's wonderful to see you again. How are you?
I'm still here.
You're looking extremely fit.
Oh, yes. I've been travelling. I've been out in the Far East and back to my old stamping grounds where I was a virgin soldier. Mm-hmm. In fact, when I was in Singapore, I went up to the barracks where I was when I was 18.
Is that where the whole thing was based around?
Yeah, yeah. I thought some of the girls I knew must be all of 21 by now, you know. But, the amazing thing is the Singapore Army have taken this over, and they're very efficient, you know. They've got a garrison there, and you need passes to get in and all sorts of things. But they showed me around, and there's one barrack block left, and it's ours, the one that our mob used to be in.
Did they leave that there because of the film, and did they write Leslie Thomas all across the front of it?
I doubt it. No, I think it's storage plate space at the moment, but they'll knock it down when they feel like it.
Right.
I mean, all that's nearly 50 years ago, you know.
Good.
It's not far short of it. Mm.
Now, the last time we were here, we started filming and the phone rang, and it was in America, and it was something to do with an award. Can you tell me something about that?
Oh, yes, it was. Well, it was a surprise. I mean, I wrote a book a few years ago called The Magic Army, and it was about Devon and the Americans who were training for D-Day and how they lost 800 men in one night. It was the basis of the novel. And it became very popular, and in America, these guys, because it was a real incident, although it was a novel I wrote it in, these guys got together, and there's a big association now of American servicemen who were involved in this operation. And they decided to give me a plaque acknowledging my book and the way that I brought the whole thing to light. And it was great, except, in fact, we had a memorial service at Arlington National Cemetery, and everything was fine, except that when it came to the dinner, and there were 700 people in the room, and I was about to be awarded this plaque, a very nice guy, who was a colonel, he was a public relations man, he came up and whispered to me, he said, "Leslie, the Pentagon has boobed again. Your award's in my safe in the office and it's locked up. We'll have to present you with a phony one." Mm. So they presented me with this somebody else's award. Unfortunately, my son was there, who was a photographer in Bournemouth, and he came to take the pictures, and we were doing something else as well. And he took this picture, and his focus was so sharp that it showed up the other person's name on the thing. Dear. So I wanted to use it for sort of publishing news or whatever. Yeah. But anyway, it was a worthwhile trip. I went on from there with Mark,
We'd gone for two reasons, the awards and the memorial service, but also we went down to a place called Tangier Island in Chesapeake Bay, and of course I write about islands.
Yes, indeed.
And we went out there, and it's amazing. We were marooned there for 5 days, couldn't get off.
The
terrible weather, I mean, you just couldn't get in a boat. And we were staying in a wooden house, and it was so windy that when you went to the toilet, the water in the toilet was flying around like that, just like being on a boat. And the worst thing about it was dry. There was no drink on the island at all.
Oh, no.
Yeah,
Stuck for 5 days.
It was terrible. Not a happy experience. And especially for Mark, who'd gone to America hoping for bright lights and women and everything. And there we were, stuck on this island. But we eventually got off and we went to New York. And since then, he's won a photography prize, and he's going back to New York in May. Two first-class tickets, week at the Waldorf Astoria, and money, and helicopter trips to do photographs. So I'm very pleased for him.
Who does the writing besides yourself and the family?
My younger son, Matthew, he's just finished his first novel. And it's taken him a long time. I had my, you know, they look at their dad and they think, oh, he does it, I can do it.
Yeah.
But Matthew can, as it happens. He's very good, and he's got industry, which is what you need. It's all right having inspiration for stories, but you've still got to put 120,000 words on paper, yeah, and that's a lot. And he's done it, and it's taken him, he must have written this book 4 times, and he's now just about finished. And I read it while I was away, and it's very good indeed.
I'm very pleased with it.
I am.
Does he write similarly to you?
No.
Or has he got a different style completely?
No, he's got a different style, and it's a different sort of book altogether. But
you write with a lot of humour, and even though it might be a very serious story, there's always this underlying humour.
Well, it happens in life. There's some funny bits in this book. It's about a school. It's about the school he went to, actually. And but it's a very tragic story in some ways, a very moving story. And he hasn't got a publisher yet. He's just got an agent.
Right.
So we're just waiting to see what happens.
Right. What happened after you came back from America? You were gone on the Orient, weren't you? You've gone somewhere. You've gone on a cruise.
I don't know. I'm always going somewhere.
No, you're always off somewhere.
I know. Well, it's good. I always say to myself,
was it a lecture cruise or something?
Yeah, I do lectures on ships and various things. In fact, next month, Diana and I are going out to Bali, and I'm doing some lectures on a lovely ship there. And but it's better than working, you know. It's a lot better.
Well, you still have to prepare your lectures, though.
Oh yes, but I do it off the cuff, more or less, you know. And I still work writing every day. I mean, I've got a little word processor there, and I can up in my tent and go off and still continue with what I was doing. Especially on ships, you can still write.
Yeah.
On a ship, you have your cabin, and you get on with it. And in fact, I've just finished a book as well. I mean, I've written, it's pretty well finished. I've got about 6 weeks rewriting to do, but that's due out next September. And my novel Kensington Heights has been came out in paperback in December, and that's been a big success. Yeah. I mean, it's sold an enormous amount of copies. It's everywhere. They even sell them in the supermarkets. So I used to think, well, maybe I was, you know, a bit snotty about that sort of thing, but I'm all for selling books.
Well, of course, it's all money, isn't it?
It's money,
and people are reading it. That's what you write books for.
I know. It's amazing. When I was out in the Far East just last week, the amount of people who'd got that book, and I can recognise it by the cover.
Yeah.
I didn't ask them if they like it, because that's fatal.
Yeah.
I mean, there's a very famous author who saw a man reading a book of his in a hotel lobby in Edinburgh. And he went over and he said, oh, that's my book. And the chap said, well, you can have it. He said, I just found it lying here. He said, it's a load of rubbish anyway. So you shouldn't really ask any. Well, I never do.
How many hours a day would you spend writing, or does it vary?
No, I don't work too hard now. I really start work about 10:30, and I'm generally finished by lunchtime. And in the afternoon, I do what I call hobby work. You know, I'm doing travel bits and what have you. But generally speaking, probably 2 hours in the morning and a 4 to 6 in the evening.
But you also do a lot of newspaper articles as well.
Not a huge amount.
I saw a very good one, and it's about this very place in the Close in Salisbury.
Yeah.
That was around Christmas time, wasn't
it? Yes. Well, what happens is it's I usually work for the Times or Daily Mail or the Mail on Sunday, and occasionally for the Evening Standard in London. But they ring up and they say, can you write something about this? And I either say yes or no. Frankly, I was expecting some calls today because I saw that the government had decided to encourage army cadets and air force cadets and all this sort of thing, you know. And the minute anything like that comes up, they're on to me. I mean, a lot of my stuff starts, I remember, it's that long ago. But it didn't happen today. But it's quite often, you know, they'll ring at, say, 11 o'clock and I have to produce the goods by 2 o'clock. And fortunately, I can do that over, you know, 1,000 words. It's no different. And the money's good. So there you are.
How long have you been living? Let's go back again, because a lot of people who've gone onto cable may have not seen the first interview that we did. How long have you been living in Salisbury now?
Do you know, we don't know. We're not sure it's 7 or 8 years. I suspect it's coming up for 8, because we signed the contract for this house on Christmas Eve, and we moved in the following September because there was so much that needed doing to the place. But my daughter and son-in-law have just moved very close to here, and I can't really see us moving from here again, not for a long time.
When you moved in here, you had an awful lot of renovations to do, didn't you?
Yeah, I'll say, yeah. But that's why we got the house.
Yeah.
You know, that's why we got the house. It's and because nobody else would take it on. But it's been worth it. I mean, it's a Georgian house now.
It's a beautiful house.
Yeah, we're very proud of it.
You've got some very famous neighbours as well as yourself. You've got Sir Edward, who we spoke to on his 80th birthday.
Yes, he's...
And you went there then. We were away, weren't you?
I was away, yeah. He invited me to the party. He's very good, you know. He's a good neighbour. He's very friendly. He did me a great favour last February. We had a Foyle's literary lunch for my novel Kensington Heights. And it was at the Grosvenor House Hotel in London. And Sir Edward said that he'd be chairman. I mean, I know he put off another appointment to come along that day, and I think chiefly because of him.
Michael King with a roundup of local news stories from the Andover Advertiser and the Salisbury Journal. Andover may be taking a step into the past in an attempt to place the town firmly on the tourist map for the future. Marketing consultants FJD from Upper Shute, commissioned by the Test Valley Borough Council, have come up with a scheme to market the town as the hub of Heritage England. Proposed plans to raise the visitor profile of Andover include introducing horse-drawn mail coaches to hark back to the mid-1700s, when Andover was a bustling market town that offered stabling to accommodate over 700 horses. Other ideas, including a heritage tour of the town, a time wheel to be erected at the Guildhall, and a national press campaign, will all be aimed at promoting the heritage of the English coaching period, and it's expected that local companies will have the opportunity of assisting by way of sponsorship. Whitchurch's most famous resident, Lord Denning, celebrated his 98th birthday this week and was reported to be on fine form. Cards and messages from well-wishers flooded in from across the world to Lord Denning's Castle Street home. The former Master of the Rolls is also the oldest member of the House of Lords. He's currently backing changes to speed up court proceedings and cut down expense, saying, "That has always been a trouble in the law, delays and cost." Lord Denning said his commitment and love for Whitchurch has never dwindled, and that the town has been part of rural England for 150 years, and that he's doing his best to preserve it as he has known it during that time. Salisbury. Furious shop owners accused the District Council of a double cross this week as they counted the cost to their businesses of Salisbury Market Square upheaval. The Council's enhancement plans for the Market and Guildhall Squares has already hit trade, they claim. But while businesses say they're prepared to grin and bear the disruption for the sake of eventually having a more attractive marketplace, there is real anger over the few parking spaces that will be left. A dog who saved a young couple and their newborn baby from burning to death in a fire at their Salisbury home is to be honoured with a bravery award. Collie Tannis will receive the Animal Medallion from the RSPCA at a ceremony at Salisbury Fire Station on February the 27th. Only 93 such awards have been made, 51 of which were given at Lockerbie. During the early hours of July the 12th last year, fire broke out in the first floor bedroom of a house in Canadian Avenue, where Nick Rainbow, his partner, Susanna Penny, and their week-old son were asleep. Two-year-old Tannis's barking woke the family and gave Mr. Rainbow vital time to call the fire brigade on a phone already melting in the searing heat, before leading everyone to safety. Go-ahead's been given for the Salisbury Festival Rock Concert. An open-air event at Old Sarum Airfield on May Bank Holiday Monday won the full backing of district councillors last Tuesday night. Not one voice spoke out against granting Salisbury Festival a licence for the concert. So keen were members of the Amenities and Tourism Committee to see the concert go ahead. They agreed that if the organisers fail to get permission to use Old Sarum, then the licence can switch to Hudson's Field. And finally, a good deed by Faberstown resident Ron Sandy will benefit sick and elderly people at the Andover War Memorial Hospital. Hearing that the ward television had been stolen from the Alan Gardner unit by mean-hearted thieves, Ron, who has recently set up a charity to help local causes, promptly provided them with a new television set. That completes the roundup of local news stories reported by Michael King. Was that all right, Steve?
Rubbish.
Sorry, somebody says it's rubbish. But
have you finished, Michael?
I have indeed, yes.
Get out, because we've got to finish this show.
Thank you, Michael.
Goodbye. Thank you.
See you next week.
See you next week.
Live on TownTV.
Here, you have this.
Oh, all right. Oh, how you doing? Thank you, Michael. Bye. Hello, Steve.
Hello.
Hello, Steve.
Hey, Stephen.
Back in the hot seat again here on TownTV. Thanks for watching this great show. We had an email in. You can send us email. It's coming up on the screen at the end of the show. It says, hi, we are avid watchers of Town TV and would like to congratulate you on a great show.
Good taste.
That was good. And that was from, best regards, Dan and Paul over in North Battersley near Romsey. So well done, Dan and Paul. We need more letters like that, don't we?
Yeah, it's very nice. They want to follow us. An autograph. Photograph.
What do they want an autograph photograph of you for?
I don't know.
Never mind. Okay.
I've got to meet these people.
Okay. Well done, Dan and Paul. Keep those letters coming in. Bye, Mike. Right. Another mic. There's another mic off camera. You had a good week, Steve? Yes. Steve's had a good week. Yes. I'm trying to fix him up with this Madonna interview and the date, you know?
Oh, not this famous Madonna interview.
The Madonna interview. If you haven't seen it, it is coming up, I promise you. It's a great, great interview.
Right.
But Steve's got something to do with it somewhere on the line. The vacuum cleaner. Mm. This very expensive vacuum cleaner.
Yeah, it's a good one.
We need... in fact, we're going to roll over this competition.
We are, because it's been popular. So a lot of people phone in again.
Yeah. And the question was, to win this super-duper vacuum cleaner, or a Hoover, is Edgar J. Hoover was the boss of an American crime-busting organization back in the 50s, I guess, wasn't it?
That's it. Yeah.
Edgar J. Hoover. Tenuous link again.
Somebody phoned in and put it on the answer machine, and it was almost, they gave us nearly his whole life story.
Did they really?
All we wanted to know was that...
the name initials. Of the... It's three initials. It's not the CIA. I can't give you a better clue than that. Mm. So ring us if you know the answer. What was the name of the organization that Edgar J. Hoover was the boss of back in America? Crime-busting organization. And it wasn't the CIA. And the telephone number to ring right now is Andover 390.
390.
Salisbury 555.
222.
Or you can fax us on Andover 390.
391.
So there we go. Do that now. Or you can write to us. You can email us.
Mm. On?
I don't know that one. I can't.
TownTV. TownTV@andover.co.uk.
Andover.co.uk.
Just put it on the screen.
We'll put it on the screen. Or you can write to us at PO Box 555. Well done, Steve. Isn't he a treasure in the background?
Isn't he just?
Mike's been working. Mike Reese has been working hard this week,
He's
too.
He's been working very hard this week. I've done quite a few things with Mike this week, and yeah, I enjoyed it very much.
He came to Cuba with me. That was a nightmare trip, but anyway, never mind. Tina from Salisbury stopped me in a bar in Salisbury. Disgusting.
A bar? You haven't been in a bar this
I'm afraid
week.
I did. I went to a bar in Salisbury. He said, why do you smile a bit more on TV like Sasha does? That's what she said. Now, Sasha took it as a compliment, but I got the hump about that. But anyway, Tina, I'll try and smile in future, just for you, over in Salisbury. What have we got? A grand charity auction. Hang on, that's something to do with the mayor of Salisbury, Beryl J.
Yeah, it is, yeah.
Where is it? That's on the 25th. In fact, we've gone and dropped everything all over the floor now. Where is it?
Covering that as well.
Where is it? Let's have a look. No, it's this one here. Thank you, Mike. Grand charity auction, Salisbury Livestock Market. If you watch this show after Saturday the 25th, you missed the auction, but we're actually going to cover that, aren't we?
Yeah.
Well done. That's Mayor of Salisbury, Beryl J. Thank you, Beryl, for that. What else we got?
What's that? New Oxfam Bookshop.
The new Oxfam Bookshop in Junction Road, Andover, is now open. I didn't know about that.
No, not
excellent selection of books. Range of second-hand tapes, sheet music, records and prints. There we are, Oxfam in 8 Junction Road, Andover. What else we got? Let me throw this one away, it's getting in the way. We've got the Salisbury Children's Library. They've got a rainforest in the Children's Library. Go and help create a rainforest. So come along on Tuesday the 11th, between 10 and 12 and 1 and 3, and Wednesday the 12th of February. All you children, come along at any time and paint, cut, stick, colour a variety of creatures to fill the rainforest. Snakes, frogs, butterflies, parrots and monkeys. The Great Green Forest at the Salisbury Children's Library.
I'd like to go to that.
Go on, yeah. You're just a child, aren't you, really?
Well, I was at the panto last week.
That's right. All you Romsey people over that way, we've got Winchester Children's Festival between the 8th and the 14th of February. Where can Winnie the Pooh rub shoulders with aliens? Who is a time wizard? And will Lazy Daisy keep her side of the bargain?
Bags not to do that.
No. That's between the 8th and 14th of February, yes, at Romsey Road, Winchester, the Tower. Mm-hmm. If you want to ring us for more details, ring us on Andover 390 or Salisbury 555-222. And finally, as we say, we've got the spring season at the Salisbury Arts Centre, where we should hopefully be opening an office shortly. It'll be quite fun.
Yeah, I'm looking forward to that thing as well.
Friday the 31st of January, we've got the Magic Wood. That's great. That's at 1:30. And February the 1st, they've got Tales at Candlemas. So ring up the Salisbury Arts Centre. They'll tell you all about those. That's great. Mm. Anything else happening? Anything else going on?
No. Just I enjoyed the panto last week.
Really?
Oh, yes, I did.
Oh, no, you did. You did enjoy it. You did enjoy it. Anything else, Steve, can you think of? Anything else, Mike? Anything else? No.
No, that's it for this week.
I think just about wraps up the show. And hopefully that Madonna interview will be coming up shortly. If it doesn't, don't blame us. Blame Madonna's lawyers. Mm. So we'll see you next week. Thanks for watching the show. It's bye from him.
And bye from him.
That's right. Bye. Bye, Steve.